zipper or buttons down the front. What is that? What is, anyone know? Anyone know? What kind of sweater are we talking about here?
The zipper.
The sweater. Vlad, what kind of sweater is that? Vlad, as long as, would you adjust your camera? I can see you. You look like, there you go. Good. Good. Okay.
Dimitri has joined us. Dimitri, will you please turn on your camera?
Dimitri.
Okay, I give up.
It's a cardigan.
A cardigan.
Is that a cardigan sweater? It's a cardigan.
As opposed to other types of sweaters, we have a pullover.
Mm-hmm.
It's another type of sweater. And as soon as it's less hot, I'll be wearing sweaters, and I wear both of those kinds of sweaters frequently.
Mm-hmm. So I thought go back to Mr. Rogers. You have a pullover, you have a vest, you have a turtleneck, you have a, maybe that's enough.
On a hot day, that's plenty.
Hot day, that's plenty.
It's only going to be 100 and something here in Texas. No sweaters.
In Texas, it's going to be, I'm there to check my weather here.
But maybe you'll leave them inside.
Yes, that's a unique feature of indoor weather.
I know that when I come to Texas to visit later in the month, I will be bringing a sweater, not for the outside, but for the air conditioning.
Frequently, Texans wear sweaters in the summer, even though it's 35 or 38 degrees Celsius outside. When they come inside, the air conditioning is so fierce, so strong, that many people get cold. So that indoors in the building, they'll wear a sweater, even though it's 38 degrees outside in Celsius. Well, Joe, we will turn it over to you.
Okay, this is the new and returning students. And we have everybody, let's see, Dimitri, would you turn your camera on, please? And we would ask you to leave your cameras on unless you have to.
Hello.
Hello. Good morning to you. It's good to see you. It's good to see everyone. Now we are all old friends, all of us, huh? We're all old friends. And welcome to the first day of school. The first day of school in Russia was yesterday. Is that right, Dima?
Yes, it's right.
Begins every class.
And what special traditions are associated with the first day of school, Dima?
Special tradition? I don't remember it. It was some years ago. Flowers. Yes, but everybody go to school with flowers and give it to their teachers.
Go ahead.
And we have special tradition of Линейка. I don't know how to translate.
Would all of you open the picture that says September 1 Liro? Do you see that picture up at the top?
Yes, yes.
Professor Liro.
Professor Liro. Okay. So here I was. This was the first day of school, and this was in Mogilev, a city in southeastern Belarus, where I had been teaching, and then I went to work in Minsk, and they called me back for Gienznani. We had Linejka, and we had Pierwis Vanok. We had Linejka. Linejka is somebody explained Linejka. Well, let's see. Konstantin, this has a bit that long. What's Linejka?
Linejka for the school? School, yeah. Linejka.
Yeah.
It's a school meeting. Everybody took part in this meeting. Mm-hmm. First classes to senior classes.
Yeah. Why is it called Linejka?
I don't know. Because maybe people stay as a soldier.
Yeah.
In one line, everybody stay.
Because we're in lines. In lines.
Yeah.
My classes. Alina, good morning.
Yeah. Good evening.
Good evening. I should say good evening. Did you when you were a little girl, did you ring the bell?
Students of first class.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, listen, it's the first day of school, so how about if you all introduce yourselves to us? Alina, tell us a little about yourself and a little about yourself. And I mean, what do you do, and what is your family like, and why are you studying English? Could you do that just briefly?
Yes, I can. I'm Alina. I'm studying school. I'm 16 years old. I study English because in the future I would like to study in Brighton College. And I think your lesson helped me to fulfill my dream. I like reading different books. I like go to teacher. I visit drama teacher, and I saw all plays. I don't know what I can say about myself. Mm-hmm. I think that's all.
Okay, well that's good. Welcome. Does anyone have any questions for Alina? No. Diana.
Good evening and good morning, everybody.
Okay. Good morning to you.
My name is Diana. I'm from Kazakhstan. I live in Omsk for 3 years and study in Omsk, but now I live in Yekaterinburg, and now I work with the children. I'm a teacher. So I was at the Linejka yesterday. So I saw all children's which went to the school. They were very happy. They had got their balloons, different colors and different size. So it was my first Linejka in the role of teacher, because all the time. I was at the Linejka as a student or as a pupil. Yesterday I've got a very very positive emotion.
And you got positive emotions. That's good. And flowers? Did you get lots of flowers?
Yes.
Yeah.
My future pupils give me flowers, so I was very glad.
Good.
And what kind of flowers did you get, Diana?
Roses.
And what color?
White color.
Very good. Well, welcome, Diana. I hope that we will help you learn something that you can use in your teaching. Konstantin, an old friend, and I mean old in the chronological sense.
Time friend.
Time.
That's right. Long
Konstantin,
time.
Tell us about yourself. Konstantin, you are backlighted. You look like you're in the witness So work on that, if not today, then for next time. So tell us about yourself, sir. Alina and Diana, a student and a teacher, and what is your occupation, Konstantin?
I'm old student in all means, because I'm old. I'm 53 years old, and because I study English in your classes, second year.
Mm-hmm.
And I live in Moscow. I have a family, a wife and two sons. My occupation is, my profession is merchant of Moscow Metro. What I can say else? I don't know. Ask me if it's interesting for you.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Diana.
Does anyone have questions of Konstantin? Anyone have questions of Konstantin? Konstantin is.
I have a question for Diana.
Uh-huh.
Or Diana, I don't know. What subject do you teach in the school?
I teach English, so English. That's why. I want to improve my English. I want to improve my English through the new technologies as this course. And I want to teach the pupils through the new modern technologies.
And what classes do you teach?
Fifth and seventh.
Sorry, fifth years.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How old are the students in fifth?
10 years old.
They are beginners, yes?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Konstantin, thank you.
Okay, I have a question for Konstantin, or I have a bone to pick with you, sir. You have to say, I have to take you to task for saying you're old. And so then what we would say is, watch who you're calling old, Sonny.
What do I call old?
Watch who you're calling old, because I'm your elder. I'm older than you are, so.
Professor Marston, please, write it.
What, 29, Professor Marston, you're only 29.
Age is a state of mind.
Yes, I write your question. What who are calling called? The people of different. I don't know. At first, I am an old student because I don't. I study English in your classes second year. Second term.
I want to point something out to you. There is confusion right now about the meaning of what word. What word? Anyone? What we have some confusion. What's the word that is causing us confusion? The word old. Because you say he's an old friend. He's an old student. Old is the word that's causing, because it has different meanings. It has to do with age.
Yes. But I mean in all the meaning, in all meaning. I'm in meaning of aging, and in meaning of
how long you've been studying.
Experience.
Okay, so we have, we will see later on in this lesson how confusion about the meaning of a word, well, it can be funny, it can be confusing, it can be a lot of things. And context is what's important here. Context is very important. Sergei has joined us, but Vlad, tell us about yourself a little bit.
Hello, everybody. Nothing has changed from last year. I'm still wet, and I'm still living in Omsk. And I know that I'm already annoying you, but I'm here again. This year I'm a 5th year student in the academy, Omsko Academy. This year is the last step of my education before cruel life, and so it will be comfortable for me if you will ask me the questions about me.
All right. And does anyone have questions of Vlad, who is in his last year before he begins his real life? He's been in an academic context until now. He's been a student. Any questions for Vlad?
So Vlad, I have a question. Because I cannot remember, I think you told us last year, what kind of law are you specializing in?
I specialize with civil law.
Civil law. So that's contracts and I'm just trying to figure out what that is. I know that means you don't chase the bad guys. You're not going to do criminal law.
Yeah.
But so this is going to be corporate law, or what does civil law mean more specifically?
Yes, you're right. It's something like you mentioned, but no, civil law is a very, very complex and very spread, and includes a lot of branches of civil law, and I can't explain it for 10 minutes, but you know, that's why I feel not sure in what sphere I will work. I'm still try to find myself.
Okay, good.
Okay, so I'm going to give you a long-range goal for when you get to real life. You might need to have what we call an elevator speech. An elevator speech. Can anyone guess what that is?
Elevator speech.
Elevator speech. Elevator speech. Those are two simple words, huh? What's an elevator speech?
I teach my students to give an elevator speech here in the U.S. too.
Do you?
This is good.
Yeah.
And so what do you tell them?
I tell them they have 3 floors. They're getting on the elevator. They see somebody who's wearing a suit and tie, and they're not. And that person asks, who are you and what are your interests or what do you do? And they have maybe 15 seconds, maybe 20. So you have to be ready. You have to have practiced your elevator speech. And that's 15 seconds that says everything about you, the big ideas, what your plans are for the future. And it's got to sound upbeat. This is an interesting phrase. It can't be negative or cynical or cast you in a bad light. You have to really say, I am so-and-so, I'm studying this, and in the future I hope to work as a civil litigator, maybe at your firm.
That's a really sophisticated elevator speech.
So Vlad may get on the elevator with somebody who runs a big company, and he would say, my name is Vlad. I'm a fifth-year student at Ohm School. I've specialized in civil law. I'm looking forward to a bright future in civil. What does your firm do in civil law? And that ties you to the person that you're speaking to, and that person will remember you because the whole idea is to make a connection.
That's so American, Pete.
It is. Self-promotion.
Self-promotion.
That's a good phrase. We need to put that in the chat box.
All right. Dima, Dimitri?
Yes.
I want an elevator speech.
Elevator
all
speech.
About Dima right now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go.
I think that you know enough about me because I study English for 3 years in this course. And I can say about myself that I am aware and I practice law. And I also work with civil law, so I represent citizens and organizations in different courts of Russian Federation.
Good. Good. Any questions for Dima?
I have one question too. Sorry, I'm full of questions today. Dima, tell me something about the last case or the current case that you are litigating.
The last case?
Yes.
I have a lot of cases, and one in the now, and one of the. Probably one of the interesting cases. I won a case against serious company in Omsk region, something about $200,000.
And what about that $200,000? You have my attention now.
So my client has this company was in debt to my client with $200,000. And so we won a case and received this money. So I helped to my client.
Oh, well, this is good. I see a big smile, too. I guess you're proud of that.
Now in a case like that, Dimitri, do you receive, are you paid by the hour, or do you get a percentage of the
usually in Omsk, we in Russia, I know that a lot of lawyers work by hour.
Mm-hmm.
So we receive money for all the case. So
mm-hmm.
I don't receive money for hours of work. So I receive for all the case. And sometimes we receive for some person from the some. Of the suit,
it's called percentage.
Percentage.
Percentage. Okay, very nice. All right, Mr. Sergey, you're last but not least.
Sorry for my late. I have a problem with the WebEx application. So I'm glad to see you again. I'm Sergey, I'm a 5-year student. Also, I'm studying law, specialized in civil law. Also, I'm working in a law company. It's a small law company. I'm working lawyer. I'm representing this company in a court. Also, like Dmitry. So. Maybe you have questions. I don't know what else I can say.
Okay. Anyone?
Question. Do you have a case that you're working on at this very moment?
Yes.
Tell us about?
Yes.
Oil is big business in Russia, right?
Oil is big business. My company where I'm working specializes on oil and gas. And now I have cases in court about debt of one company debt for my company, 2 million rubles. I don't know how much it is in dollars.
About $600,000.
Yeah, $600,000. So, $60,000 in September 10. I have a trial, and I hope that I win her and we get money and I get money.
All right. Well, welcome all of you. This is a good group. We have some new people. We have some old people, and and we're going to work on our English. We're going to start this week, and for the next 2 weeks, we're going to talk about humor. Can someone tell me what makes something funny? Why are some things funny? What makes humor, Sergey? Okay, why are some things funny and some things are not funny?
Mm-hmm. Well, for me, it's funny to, I don't know how to explain it. For me, it's funny to some TV show, Russian TV show I like, comedy.
Comedy, yeah, okay.
Yeah, comedy, I like stand-up humor when people say something, some problem in social, and try to make fun.
Try to
make fun of the problem, and I like the style in the humor.
Right. Alina, what makes something funny? Why are some things funny? What makes humor? What's funny?
Maybe when people do some funny things. I think that humor makes people. I think the humor is more interesting when it's. One second.
Dima, what makes something funny?
What makes?
Why are some things funny? What's my word?
I don't know what makes it. Sometimes you see something and you think that it's funny. Probably it's it depends with not standard situation.
Not standard. Okay, I like that. That's good. I like that. I want to look at open your do you see the tab that says FRAZZ, FRAZZ? Would you pull that down? FRAZZ, you see that? Everybody open the FRAZZ? Everybody have it open? FRAZZ, everybody see it? Yes? It's a little two-panel cartoon. We have a little kid and a big kid. A little kid and a big kid. So, let's see. Vlad and Constantine. Vlad, you be the little kid, and Constantine, you be the big kid. And go ahead and read the dialogue, please.
My dad took me ice fishing, and I caught a fish.
How long?
Only a couple of hours, but it felt like a whole week.
No. How long was the fish?
All right. My dad took me ice fishing, and I caught a fish. How long? Let's see. Good. Thank you, gentlemen. Diana, is this funny? Do you think this is funny?
It's funny because sometimes people don't understand the question and the answer. Not funny, but it seems funny for another person who asks the question. And that's why this situation can be funny.
So what is the word that makes this funny? There's this one word. What is the one word that makes this funny, that causes the confusion?
Long?
Long, exactly. Just like a few minutes ago, we had confusion over the word old.
Yes.
It's the same thing, exactly the same thing. And often, that kind of contrast, that kind of confusion about words makes it humor. In the United States, in America, when you phone somebody on the telephone, well, it used to be when there was only one phone in the house, I would call up and say, "Hello, is Diana there?" And whoever answered the phone would say, "Yes," and that's so funny. Yes, but see, because the meaning of that phrase, "Is Diana there?" Well, that has a certain semantic content. But the pragmatic force of those words in English, when you say, "Is Diana there?" what you're really saying is, could I speak with Diana? That's what that really means. And little kids, mm-hmm. when they would answer the phone, and they say, is your dad there? And the kid would say, yes. And think that that was so, so funny, to, because you're mixing the semantic content, the presence or absence of dad, with the pragmatic effect, which is, could I speak with dad? All right. So words, the kind of confusion between the meaning of words is one of the things that causes that makes things funny. Now we're gonna look at some other humor right now. And before we do this, we're gonna watch a short video. In a few pieces. It will help as we watch the video if all of you turn off your microphones right now. Just turn off your microphones. Good, okay. Because the microphone sometimes causes feedback. What we're going to do now is listen to President Ronald Reagan telling jokes about the Soviet Union. Ready? Here we go. Let's talk about this for a minute. Let's talk about this for a minute, this joke. Sergei, is this funny? Do you think this is funny?
I think yes.
Yeah? What makes this funny?
Mm-hmm. So, about Soviet Union, so, maybe it's today. Unusual situation for United States when people wait the cars in 10 years. And so, but in Russia and in the Soviet Union, it was a usual situation when people wait. You have money, but you can get it. You can buy a car. You should wait your turn. Okay.
Right. Exactly. So it would not be so funny in the United States. How about in modern Russia? Because this is not the case in modern Russia, is it?
Yeah, this is of course. This is not this in modern Russian, but for Soviet Union, for this time, I think it was funny because it's an unusual situation.
Right. Anyone now. So, what does this joke depend on? What does this joke depend on?
It's time.
It depends on time.
Yeah.
It's funny about something. 20 years ago, it was very, very funny.
Yeah.
But today, it's not so funny. Very good. All right, Sergei, thank you very much. Very, very thoughtful response. Let's listen to another story. Let me ask you a question about this. Now, I could go in today and pound on President Obama's desk and say, I don't like the way you're running your country. Konstantin, could you go to President Putin's desk and say, I don't like the way you're running the country?
No, I can do so to President Obama.
So this one is not quite as dependent on time as the other one was. Good point. All right. So some things have changed, but some things have not changed. All right. Did anybody think that was funny? Vlad, was that funny? What kind of humor is that? Does anyone know the term black humor? Black humor? Or gallows humor for those?
May need to unmute your mic at this point.
Anyone? Gallows humor. What is gallows humor?
Gallows and black, it's the same?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In this context, yeah, gallows and black. Does anyone know? Vlad, how about yourself?
Uh,
This is dark. This is dark humor. How do you dark humor? Dark humor. It's making a joke out of something that is that is grim and sort of in real life would be a very painful situation. I don't like this kind of humor. A lot of people think it's funny, but it's something that I don't have a taste for. Let's continue. Things are going to get a lot worse. All right, ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen and ladies. So all of these, you can turn your microphones back on. You can turn your microphones back on. Alina, what did you think about these jokes in general?
Maybe the man wanted to save women who drink alcohol.
Do Russians tell jokes about Americans?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody? Kiana? Sergey?
Yes.
Those jokes, what did those jokes depend on? Those jokes were all, we've already said this, they depend on time.
Yeah.
And they depend on,
I think these jokes also depend on time. So, because I think this is man was like a Robin Hood. And so, Robin Hood of this merry band.
Mm-hmm.
And so, in his moments, it's a band like gangsters and but in modern life, I think it's a band like maybe music band. I know.
That's right. Yeah. Does everyone have the picture up that's number one, picture number one? So this guy is saying to the girl, I'm in a band. And Sergey, where is this conversation taking place? Where is this conversation taking place? Where are they?
In a bar.
In a bar, yeah, sure. Yeah. They're in a bar and there's a young woman and a guy here. And so what is he doing? Diana, what is he saying? I'm in a band, but what is he really doing?
What is she really doing?
What is he really doing? The guy.
The guy?
Yeah.
He wants to Doug.
Well, Vlad has the answer in the chat right now. You see it in the chat? Vlad has put the answer in there. Okay. He's trying to pick up the girl. It's a pickup line. I'm in the band. That's a pickup line. What other pickup lines do you know? Anybody know any other pickup lines? Anybody? How about, do you come here often?
Yeah. Do I know you from somewhere?
Uh-huh. Do I know you from somewhere? What else? What other pickup line? How about, does anyone know what's your sign? What's your sign? Do I know you from somewhere?
As a teenager, to see if anybody used that line in a recent decade, Professor Zero.
I don't know. Alita, when a boy and girl meet, we're looking for input from a younger person. When a boy and a girl meet, what does the boy say to the girl to start up a conversation? Can you help us?
No.
Mm-hmm. Anyone? I'm in a band. Is this funny? Yeah, this is funny. And again, what makes this funny? I'm in a band. Well, Dimitri, what makes this funny?
Probably it's a person from different times. Probably in that time it was medium century. Medium century.
Middle Ages.
It was Middle Ages. Yes.
Middle Ages.
It was very good probably for men to be in a band.
So we have again the humor here is in that word band, because it might be the band, like guitars and drummers and piano player. That's one kind of band. And then we have Robin Hood and his band of merry men. So we have a little collision between cultures. To see the humor in this, what do you have to know? What do you have to know? You have to have an idea about British folklore, about British history, because Robin Hood was a British figure in British culture. If you lived in rural China or in rural India someplace, or on an island in the Pacific Islands with no knowledge of American culture or British culture, you could look at this cartoon and read those four words for 100 years and never see the humor of it, because you wouldn't understand. So somebody help me. What is this? This cartoon depends on what kind of context? What kind of context?
Time,
culture. Okay. Time and culture, absolutely right. Time, you need a cultural context. So we've had, so far, look at what we've seen. We've looked at time, we've looked at political systems, we've looked at cultural context. Humor depends on all of those things. Now, I want to look at another.
Before you leave this, how impressed is the woman with this line?
Aha, yeah, good question.
How do we know whether she's going to fall for the line or not?
Is the woman impressed?
No, she isn't.
And to her, it doesn't matter whether he's in a band or not. She doesn't like the way he looks.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, I want to open the tab that says Cats 001. Did everybody find it? Cats. Okay. All of you have Cats. Did you find it under the double arrow at the top? And Cats. All right. This is, I like this cartoon. Is this cartoon, does this depend on time? No. Does it depend on culture? No.
Does it depend on time?
Depends on time, yeah. Depends on time?
Depends on science.
Yeah. So what do you need? Yeah. You have to know something about mathematics, of course, yeah.
Maybe way of thinking, because the cats cannot, they don't know the physics.
Oh, now how do you know that? They certainly know applied physics.
Who has a cat? I have a cat. Professor Marson has a cat.
Maybe American cats know physics.
Oh, I don't know. I think all cats.
If you go by what they do, I mean, we can't know what's on the inside of the mind, but that's part of what makes this funny.
That's right.
Okay, now, can you imagine putting a dog where that cat is? Dogs don't know physics.
No, if you put a dog in there, good point. Then it's not funny. It's not funny. Okay, well, let's look at what we've done so far, all right? We see that context is very, very important. We have cultural context. We have temporal context. We have linguistic context. All of those things are what makes something funny, all right? All of those things are what makes sense and funny. Now, this is the beginning of the school year. We talked about the day of knowledge and the first bell and that kind of thing. And I'm willing to bet, and Deanna, I'm willing to bet that you are going to give your students an assignment to report on what they did during summer vacation, right? Am I right? How I spent my summer vacation. So open the tab that says Summer Vacation 1. Summer Vacation 1. Okay, let's see. Everybody have it? Summer Vacation 1.
Yes.
Would you describe the picture? Describe what you see here.
it's a school where all pupils or students came with their attorneys.
It's a school. Yes. So how do you know it's a school?
I see a teacher and pupils, children, and they sit.
And all of the pupils, there are five pupils, and you say everyone comes with an attorney. How do you know that those are attorneys? Let's see. Dima is locked. Vlad, how about yourself? You dreamed about it when you were in school. Vlad, how do you know those are attorneys?
Because they look like attorneys. Yeah. In his huge hats, with the papers.
The briefcase. briefcase.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Okay, so I'd like somebody to read the caption. Alina?
Yes.
Would you read the caption?
Okay. Message. My attorney has advised me that I'm not obligated to address the question of what I did on my summer vacation. Nevertheless, I would like to respond.
All right. So a kid is saying, my attorney has advised me that I'm not obligated to address the question of what I did on my summer vacation. Nonetheless, I would like to respond. Students don't talk like that, do they? Who talks like that?
Students would like to answer my teacher's question.
This is very, very formal. This is very, very official. This is very, very serious. And people who talk like that are defendants. They're usually under investigation. All right, so let's look at one more. Let's look at summer vacation two. Sergey?
Yeah.
How about if you tell us what you see here? What describe the picture and read the caption.
So I see two guards, two policemen, one pupil who read about his vacation, so it looks like a testimony in the court.
By special arrangement with the New Jersey State Police. Now, so you have a little kid, maybe he's 8 or 9 years old.
Yeah.
But he's flanked by two policemen. Who is usually flanked? Are students flanked by policemen? No. Who is flanked by policemen, escorted by policemen?
Teacher.
A criminal would be, huh?
Yeah, criminal.
Yeah, criminal, right? So what do you think? What do you think this kid did on his summer vacation?
Something criminal.
He got into big trouble. Yeah, exactly right. Summer vacation. All right, Professor Smith, you had a cartoon to share.
I think I'll follow up on your point, Professor Vero, that you've got cultural context and temporal context and linguistic context. This is a cartoon under the heading English Lit Packing Heat. And maybe, Alina, could we get you to read the read the cartoon, read the words underneath it, Alina?
My name is Mr. Coleman. I'll be teaching you English literature, and I'm armed.
And I'm armed. What does that mean, he's armed? Now I see everybody checking their machine dictionaries here. Those policemen that Professor Liro just showed you were armed. Alina, what does it tell us about Mr. Collins, the teacher?
Maybe he will teach difficult students.
Yeah, so yeah, he might be teaching difficult students, and what does that mean, he's armed? What would he bring for protection?
Maybe he has some things that can calm them.
So for his own protection, right, so he's got difficult students. I like that part of your observation. And then Vlad is helping her.
Have we locked up again? This is the second time today. This is odd. Professor Smith has locked up. Dima has locked up. Vlad is in the chat. Vlad says he's armed. Professor Marston is talking about gun control. Professor Marston, you want to amplify that a little bit? All right. Now, this is the first time today this has happened, but we've had a couple lockups. Seem to have lost Dima. Okay, well, in the United States, especially since the Newton massacre last December, some states are requiring that teachers be armed, that they carry guns in school. Professor Marston?
Yes, I'm sorry, I had mic muted and I forgot that, so my lips moved but nothing came out. There is a huge battle between the NRA, the National Rifle Association, and and people who are pro-gun control. And they've been trying to pass legislation to restrict the guns. But the Second Amendment, this is an issue which might interest those of you who are attorneys or would-be attorneys. That this is a constitutional issue, that the Second Amendment of the Constitution is about gun control, or lack of it. It's about the right to bear arms. And it's ambiguous, deliberately ambiguous. And I have just gotten a text from Professor Smith, who says that his university has just dropped off the network. He has lost his network connection, so we're probably not going to see him back again today. I'll just
All right.
say that.
Okay. Well, thanks for that. This to me, this cartoon is also dark humor. Or gallows humor, in the sense that we have an English literature classroom, for heaven's sake, and a teacher announcing that he's armed. And for those of us who have been teaching for a long time, this is a kind of difficult turn of events in a very it's a very untoward, uncomfortable direction in which some education has moved. Okay? Does anyone want to comment on this? I'm dark humor. Okay, now I want to summarize for a little bit. We have about 10 minutes left. There are different kinds of humor. We have been talking about cartoons, you know, we call these cartoons, and we have talked about jokes, the Ronald Reagan jokes. In Russian, those are called anecdotes. Mm-hmm. But there is also a thing called slapstick humor. You know what I'm talking about here? It's like slipping on a banana peel, or getting a pie in your face, mm-hmm. something like mm-hmm. that, or mm-hmm. having something like that. It's called slapstick humor, or mm-hmm. Professor Marston calls it pratfalls. That's also humor that's independent of context.
The physical kind of humor?
It's physical humor. It's physical humor.
And let's see, Steve Martin is a particularly good comedian using physical humor.
Can someone give me an example in Russian culture of physical humor? How about the kids' TV show, Ну Погоди?
No, I think it is not physical humor.
Not physical humor. Okay.
No. The physical humor, slapstick humor, it's an old circus.
Circus. Oh, that's good. Very good example. Circus humor, the circus. Clowns.
But today it isn't funny.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right.
Nobody laughs at it.
Mm-hmm. Nobody sometimes laughs at it.
Yeah, and sometimes it's cruel because, like, if you pull a chair out from someone, they may fall and hurt themselves. That's not funny to me.
Sometimes it's funny, but in very, very, when there are a bit of humor. For example, in your comedy, in your old comedy too, I forgot the name. Small episode when the heroes slap one each other with a pie.
Pie in the face.
Funny, mm-hmm. but if it is the main theme of the cartoon or of the film, it's a nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
And I think nobody funny at it.
Okay. So far, so good. Listen, your assignment for next time, and I will post this on the Webelang site. The assignment for next time is for you to do two things. One, to present an anecdote.
In English?
Huh?
To present it in English?
Yes.
In English, yeah, an anecdote.
And in English, I would call a joke.
Okay. And I would also like you to upload an English cartoon, find an English cartoon about teachers or about school and explain it to us. All right? Would that be okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've written that down in the chat as well.
Okay. All right. Now, Vlad, you told us in your written introduction that when you were in the United States, people told you that you resembled an American actor. right? And yeah. who is that American actor?
I will show you the picture,
uh-huh.
which I made in the United States.
Okay, can you upload
year.
It?
Yeah.
Would you upload
sure.
it for us now? Yeah.
Sure. Before United States, I never heard about this actor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I enjoyed reading your account of your experiences. Talk about pickup lines.
Yeah. His name is Lucas Haas.
Oh, there it is. Okay. If you would all pull down the tab, 9WVPC, do you see it, 9WVPC? All right. So is that you, Vlad, or is that this guy?
Trying to guess where is me.
Which one is you?
Yeah. But
well, that's good. Wow. Okay, now stay right there. Sergey, do you think they look alike?
Yeah, I know where it's at. Actually, I was with him when the situation happened in New York. So, Vlad in the middle.
All right, Vlad's in the middle. Diana, yeah. Is that? We don't know if Sergey is misleading us or not. Diana, which one is Vlad?
I think that he's in the middle of the picture.
Yeah, yeah. So what's similar, what's different?
It's because of a bad quality of middle photo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, I think that the difference are in the ears. Yes?
Oh, yes.
I don't know.
Yeah, that's good. I think that ears.
Yeah.
I know. I have a friend who's Canadian, and she has a Canadian passport. And unlike our passports, one of the pictures in the passport has to be sideways, showing an ear, because ears are so unique.
Uh huh.
And the other thing that I notice is this actor has pouches under his eyes, whereas you, Vlad, look like you slept a little more.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Alina, what do you think?
I think his name Vlad, yes?
Mm-hmm.
I think Vlad is in the center.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay. Well, that's very nice. Okay.
Can I ask one question, Joe?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Would you please, everyone, take a minute in the chat and write either a summary of what we did today or something new that you learned? A summary of this class written in the chat, or just one thing that you've learned.
One thing that you learned. Go ahead and put it in the chat. We will probably ask you to do something like this at the end of every lesson, okay? To kind of wrap, pull things together. Okay, as you're doing that, I also want to remind you that you have two Webelang assignments to do. One is to record a oral proficiency sample. I'm not sure that's the right term, but we want you to read a specific text and record it on Webelang, and also answer some questions about it. And this will be one of the ways that we and you will be able to gauge your progress during the semester. And the second thing is to write your little introductory essay on Webelang. And it's on the America and Americans Today Fall 2013 thread. Let's see, have I sort of...
I would add, if for any reason you can't make the audio recorder on Webelang work, and it has been working well, you can do what I did and record a video on your phone if you have that capacity, and you can upload it. This last week, those two videos that were uploaded onto Webelang are the first two video recordings that I have made. So I'm all excited about another new use of technology. It's one of the things that I've been using myself with these days. So give it a whirl. If you have any trouble with the technology, don't use that as an excuse. Keep trying till you get something done. It's very important to have this early benchmark. It's important for you, and it's important for us as well. And I just want to congratulate you. This has been a really good session, you guys.
Good session. This is a good group. I'm looking forward to next time. Let's see, does anyone have any concluding comments? Professor Shestakov? Professor Shestakov, anything?
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah. So